Hello everyone, today we talk about Western European tactics between the 11th and the 14th century, 14th not included, we will stop to the 13th, but also give some hint about what actually happened in the following century, because it's still part of these broader evolutions, so this timeline is rather arbitrary in many ways. Also, as you understand, this is just an introductory video. Sometimes I don't even know why I embark myself in such desperate enterprises to condensate such topics in just one video, but I thought it could be interesting as a general, you know, overlook over this period that naturally I will be analyzing in greater detail on Schwerpunkt, and I already began to do naturally, but this can be useful for anyone who, you know, just wants to look at the essential, if I'm obviously if I'm able to deliver such an explanation effectively, and then can be the starting point for, you know, deepening the rest. So as you understand, most of the European tactics at this time revolved around the charge of the mailed horsemen. So the development of heavy cavalry is something that in Western Europe during the Middle Ages is something that goes in parallel with the development of feudalism, and this is always the base of every kind of military history you wanna deepen, analyze, history of the art of warfare. You have to look not just only at the epiphenomenal military element, as you know, armies and their tactics and so on, but also looking unavoidably at a broader level, not just strategical during the campaigns, because objectively you can't study a battle without having studied the relative campaign, although it can be kind of seducing, like, you know, I take just the battle and we go. Also in Schwerpunkt I do, for the sake of, you know, of brevity, which is already quite difficult thing to achieve in my channel, you know, to isolate, let's say, a battle, also because campaigns, stone literature, are very, very complicated to analyze, and they take into consideration a huge amount of things. In my master's degree, it took me one whole year to write a thesis on a campaign of the end of the 13th century that actually lasted for, you know, in its major part, only for a season, practically. So you can imagine, and this just for a campaign in the 13th century. Can you imagine, you know, if you studied Napoleonic Wars and so on? So obviously we have to be concise sometimes, but we can't avoid, when studying military history, to look at politics and society, because without these you can't properly understand why warfare evolved in such, you know, in the way it did historically. And in the case of this period in history, definitely feudalism was about this. The idea is that also, what is feudal cavalry? Because this is also an approximation. We can essentially, in a nutshell, we could define this as essentially a mounted elite that was provided by this highly stratified society into Western Europe that began to form in such a fashion essentially from the 8th century, although this is also an approximation because kind of the heavy cavalry always existed in some way. But from that period, that is the Carolingian times, there was a marked increase in professionalism that arrived essentially from the concentration of resources in the hands of this elite that rendered available the in fact the resources, including time, not just material ones, to become a professional military elite. And this is in a nutshell the nature of feudal knighthood in this period. And this had an evolution, because naturally the 8th century Carolingian knight is not a 10th century Ottonian knight, as it's not an 11th century Norman knight, and definitely not a 13th century French knight. but let's say that, first of all, there is a kind of a homogeneity in the way this system developed. It was a very slow process. We see that cavalry substantially you know, every kind of army evolved throughout history. So, but this was very low, because at the time technological potential was really low, society was not speeding up for many other reasons. So if you look at the essentials objectively, even at 13th century, up to the 13th century, even if you want to just look at equipment, a knight was not, let's say a 13th century knight in the essentials was not enormously different from an 8th century knight. From that century specifically, there is a, you know, an acceleration also on technical, you know, developments, of technological developments, as you want to call them. There is, for instance, plate armor that pops in and gets developed, and indeed if you look at the late medieval centuries, you realize that there is a, compared to the previous centuries, a brutal acceleration in the development of the armies in many ways. You can argue that also from the 14th century, the hegemony, the uncontrasted hegemony of heavy cavalry on the battlefields was kind of stopped. Not that cavalry stopped being important, on the contrary, it would always remain. Until essentially the end of the 19th and beginning of the 20th century. But the concept is that the, in fact, also in here, it's not just a tactical predominance, it's really a socio-economical, a political and social predominance that kind of gets interrupted by other factors. Certainly true towards the late Middle Ages, especially after the second, after the mid 14th century, there's a sort of re-feudalization of warfare, so that cavalry kind of, it's not much that this strengthened in itself, this also relative terms, but it's kind of, you know, the infantries of the first half of the 14th century, especially with the Black Death and so on, kind of got wiped out in part, also demically speaking, so that's also why society is important. So that cavalry reacquires sort of heavier specific weight in those last centuries before the eventually the development of Renaissance warfare from essentially the mid 15th century with these squares of thousands of pikemen that were extremely effective against as a in terms of stopping power and for cavalry, and now we're also advancing, because that's also a great difference that you can find, for instance, for the infantries of the early 14th century, if not occasionally and not, you know, systematically, definitely not effectively. But this is another chapter. We will discuss extensively also late medieval warfare. Something I'm saying now, it can sound new to you, but these are really essential, so please, you know, if at least you disagree, go check something out, because this is really how important it is. And also, looking in fact at these previous centuries, you realize that there is a development, however, of cavalry. You can argue that, especially the full predominance of heavy cavalry, of feudal cavalry, as you want to call it, on the Western European battlefields, is something that really happens only from the mid, kind of late 12th century. And all the 13th century. The 13th century is actually the acme of the of feudal cavalry predominance on the battlefields. There is, which is very interesting, because the 13th century is also a substantial moment of development of infantries that would kind of prelude to the consequences of the following century. But it's the moment in which heavy cavalry is so strong that these developments in infantry are not sufficient, essentially, to contrast this mounted elite effectively in open field, especially. Also, towards the very end of the 13th century, you start finding certain, especially in the English-Scottish Wars, something that was preluding towards that, but it's never quite a pitched battle in which, indeed, there was this real victory of infantry over cavalry, because let's be honest about this, infantry always existed at this time, and it was actually a fundamental component of these feudal armies, even if the medieval literature that was mostly written by the for the knightly elite tended to discredit essentially the role of infantrymen. But even if you look at the Crusades, for instance, the interaction between infantry and cavalry was vital in many ways at a tactical level. But let's say that before, this is the great difference before this series of battles that essentially follow clamorously with a great throughout all the first half of the 14th century for, you know, distance just a few years in sequence one from the other, beginning with the Battle of Courtrai, or Courtrai, as you want to pronounce it, infantry. And this is the point. From essentially this mid-12th century, had not been able to withstand alone a charge of mailed horsemen, of this elite. Which doesn't mean they didn't, because there are countless examples throughout all these centuries of infantrymen that actually stood against the charges of heavy cavalry, even resisting for an incredibly long time. For instance, the clashes between the Swabians and the Lombard League show a great amount of these events. But infantry, let's say, at this point was not tactically independent. In order to win a battle, the decisive element was always heavy cavalry. And even though these two arms mutually supported each other and therefore together also achieved great results also in this external world of Western Europe during the Crusades, for instance, infantry was kind of subservient, was kind of dependent on cavalry, heavy cavalry. So for the sake of brevity, when I say cavalry in here, and without further specifications, I'm meaning the mount, the armored elite cavalry. So I will be repeating this a lot, so it's going to be useful. So as we've seen, this was reflected also on a political and social prevalence. Feudalism at this point in the 13th century is the hegemonic form of institutional and political form essentially in Western Europe, and it's this is really the point. The other communities, the communities of commoners, essentially, hadn't the necessary strengths, albeit were kind of building them up during these centuries, to effectively defeat heavy cavalry in open field. For other times, if you look at, you know, I don't know, if you look especially at asserted, this is the point, the feudal system was not rooted. That's paradoxically where you know, the cavalry had more difficulties, because feudalism didn't expand also in here just, you know, for no reason, without without a why, let's say. Feudalism required, for instance, also environmental sustainability. If you take, I don't know, the Celtic fringe and the British Islands, that's not France. If you take, I don't know, same also other border regions, like you can take Germany, for instance. So let's say everywhere that where cavalry not only couldn't just be sustained from the local society, because the society was too kind of egalitarian, less stratified, and also more primitive, and actually poorer, because this is also a problem. But it's also a matter of terrain, for instance. Feudalism went in parallel with things like deforestation, reclamation, so all also a transformation of landscape that was, in this sense, kind of also functional to mounted combat. So it's actually full of examples throughout even this era of, let's say, especially the outskirts of feudal Europe, of regions, of contexts, of warfare, where such heavy cavalry actually had problems. Because the terrain was not suitable, because the horsemen had to dismount, many reasons for this, and but chiefly because these were areas where feudalism did not spread. And in throughout these centuries, you can even see a geographical spread of feudalism. For instance, this is the century; these are the centuries from the mid 12th century to which the true French feudalism is exported into Germany. It's not that Germany to that point had not known feudalism, but let's say that it had taken another form. It was kind of less developed than what eventually Frederick Barbarossa created in there, and that's that corresponds, in fact, also to the progressive abandonment of this and the decline of Germanic infantries that had existed and were pretty strong up to that point. You know, when one of the greatest Carolingian defeats, one of the few actually, had been the Battle of Zunta, when at that time the Carolingian cavalry was effectively contrasted by the Saxon infantry. Germany at this point, still in the 11th, 12th century, was, you know, covered largely in forests, in swamps, and etc. So what you see also in many battles that occurred, these civil wars between the various Germanic, the chunks that made up the Eastern Frankish kingdom at this point, you realize that it was a big deal of, you know, reliance, for instance, on these natural obstacles, a lot of dismounted warfare, and this probably developed in Germany also certain types of kind of fighting that we will see now, that brought also to perhaps a certain characteristic equipment. So you can say that the very core of feudal Europe is essentially northern France, and also today is roughly Belgium, and in southern England, practically, or England as a whole, depending, because actually also in there was a kind of an expansion. That was the real core. Throughout these centuries, these feudal forms expand, even into countries that had not properly been conquered by, I don't know, that had not seen actually the imposition of Frankish feudalism back in the day. Think about Spain, for instance. Spain, aside from the Catalonian mark in the northeast, kind of at this point gets very heavily Francicized. I don't know if I can use this term, by itself. And this is a complex process that now I don't have time to explain once again. But you know, if you go into my medieval society playlist, you'll find something about feudalism and how it formed, and it explains you why this model eventually was the winning one. Because it was exported everywhere. It was exported in Scandinavia. It was exported into this also Baltic lands. It was becoming essentially, and actually for many centuries, you have to think that this fringe of feudal Europe kind of remained even throughout the modern age. I mean, if you take the so-called Celtic fringe in the British Islands, you realize that feudalism, as it was known in other countries, kind of didn't practically develop. It developed in other ways, in a much more asphyctic way, and this also influenced accordingly the local warfare. And this is also kind of an approximation, because also what does it mean feudal? You can say that, of course, also the Celtic fringe kind of got feudalized in many ways. It did. It was still a feudal society, but when we say feudal, is kind of an approximation also by saying, you know, more, it's something more related to the practices of the conferment of a fief than anything, because actually every society is feudal in the sense it's clientarily, especially in this period. So it's something that you have to look at mostly at wealth redistribution, how much wealth was concentrated in the hands of a few, and that's what gives you the mounted horsemen, the heavily armored horsemen, because if you don't have the resources to concentrate in the hands of very few, you can't have that very few so very well trained and armored. And remember that the predominance of mounted combat at this point, in these specific times and places, didn't derive much from the equipment in itself. It obviously was something also very difficult to match, because at this point there wasn't much objectively that was much effective against armor let's say, also, especially in terms of projectiles, and not even the crossbows had an enormous, but we'll talk about it later. But the point I was making was the most important thing here, and you have really to sculpt in your mind with gigantic characters, is that these guys had an enormous collective training. This is what makes the difference 99% of the time when it gets to you have to look at the quality of a fighter. It's not about the individual fighter, because maybe during even during early medieval times, a migration era cavalryman maybe was individually more skilled than a 13th century knight. That also could be, it's a bit of a relativistic statement, because also it means skilled, yeah, okay, but to do what? Because also a 13th century knight is kind of probably the epitomization of professionalism in every kind of time in history. What really made the difference in that case specifically was the collective training, that is, how effectively you're able to fight on formation. Because what makes the difference in a battle is not how cool and good and skilled you are individually, but how much you can work in formation and how much you can deliver this force effectively all at once in an orderly fashion. And if you look at feudal Europe, this is the real difference that it made. Not the incredible, objectively incredible individual level of training, also in, you know, individual fight that definitely existed for these knights, but also and especially and prevalently the collective training, knowing how to keep formation during a cavalry charge. This was what all Western warfare revolved around, and there was no way out. And in the later centuries of the Middle Ages, this naturally this thing would remain, but there is an evolution also towards a certain type of, you know, specialization, towards different, also the differentiation of cavalry, something that kind of kicks in, because towards the late Middle Ages, for instance, cavalry, heavy cavalry kind of gets always heavier, so it also had certain handicaps when it got to, you know, carry out certain operations, and that's why you distinguish, for instance, you see in the late Middle Ages, there are even horse archers that appear into Western armies. Also this time there were horse archers, also because, by the way, the same feudal nobility at this point was perfectly skilled to use bow and arrow, given that they, you know, they when they were not at war, they spent all the time at home hunting. Maybe just in winter when everything was covered in snow, they stayed in within, you know, their castles, and so on. But these guys were always on horseback and could use every kind of weapon, even missile weapon. It would be perfectly normal, for instance, for a knight this time to have a crossbow on horseback. And even if the sources do not show you, because at that time it was considered immoral, at least for the ideal standards of chivalry, medieval knights could fight kind of in every fashion, and with every weapon. But what really made them so effective was the cavalry charge. And this cavalry charge was not successful just within this Western world, but actually if you see when the Westerners kind of go out of this Western world, especially in the Holy Land, in the Near East, and so on, you realize that many other powers that weren't, that didn't have the same feudalism the Westerns had, if not perhaps the Persians, and by a certain extent certain Turks, everybody recognized that this was kind of the strongest heavy cavalry that they had ever met, and these guys were incredibly courageous, brave, effective, trained, maybe a bit indisciplined. A great problem here was also that these guys were very highly trained, but not necessarily very disciplined, and although there was a very high standard of discipline, this was enforced progressively over a system that otherwise didn't look at that. And this also had to do with the progressive strengthening of the monarchies, so also in this ability of framing these knights, these noblemen, into a hierarchy for which they had to obey, and this is how also you give discipline to an army, because before, otherwise, these knights were coming from a mindset, from a background that basically made them conceive their own king just as a primus inter pares, that is, essentially, every other noble was in high noble, let's say, was necessary, could be theoretically eligible for becoming a monarch, for instance. There is a lot of wars in this time in feudal Europe that are fought over such things. So, also this this world is dominated still by certain kind of individualistic edis. I mean, not really dominated, but let's say characterized by certain of individualistic edis that gets progressively stamped to make all this, you know, the wall formation, the wall army more disciplined. Mm-hmm. And in fact, there is a big deal of difference between, you know, a knight of the 11th century and one of the beginning of 14th. Also, the market of war was radically different. Society was radically different. I mean, not radically. That's not exaggerated. I mean, I use certain strong words to make you understand, you know, to underline, to emphasize the differences. These were, as we have seen, not radically different societies, but in the surface, let's say, epiphenomenally speaking, they definitely had very different characteristics. 11th century Europe is essentially a very, still very primitive, kind of rural world with a few monetary circulations. So on the end of the 13th century is an enormous, massive, interconnected system with lots of financial resources, great demographic strength. So it's a very different thing. Excuse me, I drink a little bit before I go on. So you realize also how, from a military point of view, you necessarily have to take into consideration certain other elements. So if you look at tactics, since we should focus on it, I can say this heavily armored knight or feudal man at arms, if you want to call it, is often associated to the tank of medieval warfare. And it's kind of, you know, I'm not a great fan of this analogy, but it's still kind of nice. First, if anything, because these knights were covered in armor in many ways, and especially towards the end of this period, were growing, in fact, so heavy at a certain point that they were increasingly relying more help. An 11th century Norman knight, for instance, was an extremely dynamic individual who could, you know, jump back and forth, you know, could dismount at every time, could adapt to any kind of warfare. Towards the end of the 13th century, this is still true, because it actually remains true at every time in the history of cavalry, but we still assist to this kind of, you know, specialization towards, you know, the idea that there is a heavier knight in a unit that it essentially has to be as heavy as possible. So being extremely effective for a cavalry charge, for instance, but not being so suitable for other operations, for which there were other cavalrymen that were initially squires or sergeant or maybe other kind of lighter cavalry associated, that increasingly got even more specialized, especially during the 14th century, but we don't have time to talk about this. So the idea is that sometimes these guys were so heavily armored that they couldn't even objectively move or you know, interact with the surrounding environment very, very effectively. Actually, it's plenty of evidence also from, you know, experimental archaeology and so on, that it shows how this knightly armor was not excessively heavy at all. It was designed especially in a perfectly ergonomic way, for which the movements were not hampered at all. You could really do a lot of acrobacies actually in armor, even with plate armor back in, you know, ahead in the late Middle Ages. So it's all witness, but nevertheless it's very exhausting, and this kind of cavalry can't do excessively much in practice. And this is true, especially when you're on information, because information, we have seen how the effectiveness is kind of related, it's to the complexity of, to the unity of the system. Now, the larger system is, the more there is attrition factors. Wearing a armor is extremely tiring. Also, think about, you know, staying under the sun, also under the weather, or other kind, you know, when it's cold, when it's also something. You know, your body is essentially consuming calories to move. You know, your muscles have to move, also adding this extra weight. And think about all the stress, all the exhaustion you had during a combat. Mm. So it is true that this armor was perfectly capable of allowing you certain movements and so on. These men were actually trained, and they were very fit, because they trained with armor on and using this their full gear. But nevertheless, it was exhausting, and we all know that in military history there was never a clash that lasted more than a few minutes, because continuously, because this was, you know, the human body kind of gets exhausted. It doesn't matter how much you train, and that's a physical limit nobody can surpass. So actually, we'll see it later, battles where actually this kind of intermittent clashes that lasted a few minutes, for which, you know, all these knights kind of fell back, they refreshed, they drank, they ate something, they rested, and then after some time they launched themselves once again into combat. And this is really how, you know, it's not just about feudal warfare, this is actually how every kind of melee works like. And many people ignore this. They think just battles were this continuous clash between armies that stayed for, I don't know, hours or fighting continuously. This is not how battles ever worked in history. But aside from this, we'll see maybe later, the important is this: the analogy of the tank is important and extremely and important and definitely vital in this warfare, were squires. They're kind of the forgotten heroes of feudal Europe, because these were not noblemen, so theoretically they weren't worth a damn. Just remember that these were jerks, let's be honest about this. This feudal elite was a bunch of cocky bastards who basically were a bunch of pillagers and murderers, and they were also quite psychologically fucked up, because let's be honest about this. Who believed they were even in a sort of crypto-racial way superior to the other people. Like they thought that they stemmed from this a nobility that was lost in the midst of time, that had, you know, from where they had been selected throughout this massive effort of being essentially a race of fighters. And everybody who didn't fight, who wasn't part of that club or that class, was rubbish. You know, if you were someone who fought on foot, you were rubbish. You were a heartworm. You were scum. You were not worth anything. And this is really how what symbolizes the, you know, the actually the predominance of these cavalrymen, because they actually saw on the battlefield that they were superior in their way of fighting, in their hegemony. It was all one thing with the political and social one. Naturally, as in whole history, you know, these guys were also taught very, very harsh lessons, however they were tending also in the sources to kind of neglect the work of other elements of society. Feudal armies could not work without commoners who knew, for instance, how to bring the technical abilities, the materiel, the resources for siege warfare, for instance. You have necessarily to have infantry to occupy one position and to hold it. You necessarily have squires who tell the knight, and this is what it resembles to a tank in warfare, you know, especially towards the 13th century, the knights basically fully enclosed their face with these great helms, and for which they had this very thin eye slits and you know, a bunch of holes for breathing, and that's all. And that's something that really hampers your view, your sight, your hearing, that also very important in warfare. And this form of helmet developed also is a very effective indicator of what warfare was transforming to. You know, this practically increasing specialization always only towards the charge, the straight charge. That's what you can get from a great helm in its functionality. That these knights were essentially transforming not in an extremely dynamic thing that could be flexible and used to fight in several conditions, but increasingly concentrated, albeit being able to do also those other things, but increasingly functional and specialized for that cavalry charge, because that's how conflict was, how battles were resolved, at least during the 13th century in practice. And with such, you know, being enclosed in this oven, also with your gambeson over your head, because, you know, you had this essentially padded garment around your hand, also because you can't wear objectively armor over your skin, because it's, you know, it's gonna be extremely uncomfortable and damaging as well. And you can't, you have only these isolates. And squires in this were extremely important because they literally shouted to their masters, you know, look left, look right. This is exactly how a tank works, you know, with a tank commander and then the guy who shoots and the guy who drives, and this is kind of similar. And these squires were so vital because they didn't just stay back. They also joined the fight. They took away their wounded masters. You know, they saved their lives and they got into the melee, also risking a lot because they were less armored than the other knights. And without them, objectively, even in terms of, you know, logistical matters, you know, they really helped a great lot their masters. Now, squires also throughout this period have a kind of an evolution for which they get increasingly heavier. Especially the more, you know, the feudal elite kind of narrowed down and became more powerful, and the more also these squires began to be not really serfs, but actually they could be, I don't know, young noblemen that were joining these more mature fighters to learn the craft, because actually there is also this very strong analogy. You know, this was a world dominated by corporations. With masters, you know, with crafts, with masters and the assistants, warfare was exactly in the same way. The knight was the master of the craft of war, and the other guy was following in order to learn and not just and to help in the meanwhile, but also learning the craft, you know, on its own. And this is the tendency that kind of increases. And this mounted elite was conceived to have this, what is, you know, very graphically and effectively described as mounted shock combat, because it was objectively about the shock. Sometimes in the sources, you even find in vernacular language, I found it in German, for instance, shock, just like the modern word. Because this is the idea. It's a very onomatopoeic sound, kind of gives you the idea also of this impact, okay, that happened. Just think about all these mailed horsemen kind of clashing together. Can you imagine the round? Like, it was also something very, this is what you get from the sources, was a very visual, and you could understand the strength, the physical strength involved in today's war. And this was simply because of what the nature of tactics were about. This was these units of heavy cavalry that looked like a very close packed mass. Mm-hmm. Sources really stress how thickly packed these cavalrymen were. There are some sources that say, you know, not even wind could pass through between one soldier and another, for how, you know, the word knee to knee, shoulder to shoulder. Mm-hmm. This is what the collective training was about. You know, being able to stick together. It's not easy on horseback. To, you know, you need also horses. Horses were extremely trained, and that's they were the best breeds. They were extremely obedient. You can't have a good cavalry without good horses. If the knight sucks, if the knight is not good and the horses is good, that cavalry is not good. If the knight is good and the horse is not good, that cavalry is not good. In order to have good cavalry, you need to have good knight and good horse, and you need them to know each other, to have fought together. The relation between the knight and his horse is something atavic, something, you know, visceral in many ways. Yeah, they have to know each other, they have to rely on each other, because both the man and the horse know they're going to war, they're going to the fight, they know they might die, so they need to feel they rely one on the other. And there is also here beautiful literature. This is not true just for the Middle Ages. Cavalry is based essentially on this relation. So this mass charged essentially with their lances, were naturally the weapon conceived for cavalry charges, and at this time the prevalent grip was to keep, you know, it was underarm, you know, this or keeping the legs securely secured, safely secured on under your armpit, and that is a very functional way to kind of also absorb the impact, by the way, because you have to imagine also the forces involved in here. If you don't handle these weapons safely, and you don't know how to absorb an impact, you break your arm. Point. You either break your wrist, you break your elbow, your arm is gone. And just think how important it was also at that time to be physically fit, because if you know, all your life is about war and you're crippled, you know, it's not gonna be. In fact, something that always made me extremely curious that I never found in sources, you know, just think at the amount of crippled knights that existed at the time. Usually from the source, medieval sources, we think about this mass of, you know, deformed or crippled people in, you know, among the poor, you know, among this strata of kind of you know, abandoned, this kind of paraclete. But what about the knights? These were people who fought all their life. They all had, you know, some broken bone, and it was actually very of course you can fight, especially on horseback. You need to be extremely fit in many ways. Consider that also remaining on horseback requires iron tykes, because that's also what you know, your legs have to absorb many force, many stress. In this point, you have to be extremely fit to go on horseback. Excuse me, drink a little once again. But also here, it wasn't just a matter of physical strength. That objectively, military history has never actually made a big deal of difference, but rather of skill in many ways. So it was all about the training, and as we have seen, the not just the individual but also the collective one. So the underarm grip is something that you say, oh well, this is where essentially knights began to charge more in this more orderly fashion. Yeah, let's say that it's more functional that way, but however, never think that this was kind of the standard thing. Because aside from the fact that throughout these centuries that we're taking into analysis now, between the 11th and the 14th, and the 13th, comprehended with the 13th, there is an evolution. But in general, because for instance, the Norman knight, I don't know, if you look at the Bayeux tapestry, you see a freaking lot of Norman knights with an overarm grip. Mm-hmm. Also actually showing them throwing these lances, because always consider that lances also at this point were thrown. And they were used as projectile weapons. But towards the 13th century, said this couché underarm grip is kind of more... it's kind of the essential, okay? But in war, objectively, literally, you know, it was literally all over the place. You can't see knights at all times in history, literally all times. I mean, even when there were this kind of huge lances towards the end of the Middle Ages, from which you had to use the rest because they were physically too heavy to lift and so on, you see knights using them in the most incredible ways. This is kind of normal because we are humans and that's what we do. We're not machines, we're not, you know, even, you know, when you are into melee and you are under, you know, there are people who are just hammering you with every kind of weapon, it's a mess, you're covered in blood and guts and shit, and you freak out. And you, even if you're the best trained fighter ever, you essentially start behaving like a primitive ape, like using weapons even in a way they're not supposed to be used like. But generally speaking, also, this is not just about freaking out, this is objectively a matter of, you know, what the situation can be. There are moments in which, you know, it's more profitable to use your legs, your, like a throwing weapon, for instance, than using a couché underarm grip. And there are spaces and times where this happened more frequently. For instance, if you take the Iberian Peninsula, rather famously, where these kind of jinetes what were these, they were knights, just like in all the rest of Europe, and there was just like in the rest of Europe the same social segmentation with the armored knight and then the other the squires and the other troops and so on. Of course, maybe Spain was a bit less stratified than France on average, but it's just because France was the exception, but substantially these were all the same. And but you see that in Spain there was a greater use, for instance, of the of lance as a throwing weapon, and also the equipment was kind of more adapted to this kind of more hit and run tactics, this skirmishing. Also the shields were different, usually smaller and round on average than what they were, I don't know, in northern France, in England, where they were taking the drop shield form, how you call it, the knight shield, I don't remember. So this but this is kind of a secondary element. This is kind of a superficial difference, and it's not really what essentially changed the nature of this fight. In fact, one thing you have to remember, and I think it's very useful, because there are many prejudices related to the you know, to this idea we need to categorize. You know, as moderns, sometimes I do it on Schwerpunkt as well. For instance, on Schwerpunkt, I make certain videos to say, okay, let's give a look to the knight of this particular region of this particular country of Europe between these centuries. And I do it because it's a chance to talk a little bit also about what that country was, the situation. So, but if you look at the essentials objectively, there wasn't much of a difference, or maybe that difference was superficial, and it does help to tell us something about that particular context in terms of political and social terms. But in essentials, it's the same. If you take a knight in the 13th century from Portugal to Poland, or from Norway to Sicily, they're practically the same thing. They're essentially the same thing. They could have another outlook. Naturally, you have to imagine also think about the heraldry or certain customs, certain many other elements. Think about all these crests, this difference in the, but the essentials was an armored knight with a helm, with a coat of mail, with a shield, with a sword, and with a lance. And that's literally it. And also their equestrian abilities were substantially the same. When we say things like, I don't know, the best cavalry at this point was the French one. It is right in the sense that the French cavalry was objectively, France was the country where there was the highest concentration of resources into the hands of few. So this means that on average, French nobility was more powerful and also better equipped and presumably also better trained, because we see it also from the sources, than others. But probably the difference in there was also much of how this was organized, because the Kingdom of France, especially from the 13th century, is also something that grows more kind of unitary, that is able to field more troops at once. It's a great difference that it makes from other countries like, I don't know, Germany, where everything was fragmented, for instance, and or Italy, that was even more fragmented, because in there, maybe individually, the knight was perfectly fine, it was just like a French one, but altogether, maybe they had not joined into this greater expeditions with this greater organization, and at that point, it's not even much about actually the cavalry tactics. It's really about the logistical development, the availability of resources, also the development of certain certain technical siege capabilities that have not really to do with the essential of the knight. That is practically all the same. And at this time, also a great prestige was naturally attached to the social status. Actually, the difference in military quality is very difficultly observable. This is a problem I would like actually to go in detail with also with my studies, because it's a question I've always posed myself. One chapter of my PhD thesis is going to be now, actually, about this in a specific context. Now I can't go in detail, but this is the point. You know, is this, because there were prejudice, kind of stereotypes also at the time. I don't know, those were the best knights, those were worse, but is it true? Are the sources that are telling us this for apparent no reason, or is it, or is it whether that there was a real superior? And telling the truth, in my opinion, there were contexts that produced better warriors in theory. This has to do with a lot of factors that are very difficult to scope. It has obviously to do with the degree of militarization of society, but not just that. It's also about the resources, who owns them, and how they are distributed. So it's very complicated, actually, and especially given the nature of this medieval sources, it's extremely difficult to draw this line, saying these were better than others. And even if we're still talking about, maybe this, we concentrated feudal elite and these knights, still, there were so many other ways you made war with. Mm. For instance, the Genoese crossbowmen were considered the best in Europe. Now, what measure do we have for saying this? Was it that the Genoese crossbowman was more trained than others? Or is it maybe because, you know, the Genoese form of, of organization of these crossbowmen and their ability of delivering them somewhere else and acting in formation, in fact, having this more kind of functional, this more trained units made them more effective? Because in that sense, also technologically speaking, it's naive to say, you know, I don't know, the Genoese had the best technology, because technology is something that basically stands. The problem is, if anything, you know, who has the resources, for instance, to use that technology, and that surely the Genoese probably were wealthier than other places in Europe, so they could invest more in such things. But at this point, also the differences in technologies and asymmetry in general is very low. You know, even if you take Europe, the Mediterranean, the Near East, the Middle East, you realize that, yeah, there were many differences, but in essentially, these countries were all kind of the same. And the more you try to draw a difference, the more you really realize that there is practically not. Because even certain military systems, of course, the Near East, for instance, didn't have the same good heavy cavalry than the Western Europe. The Middle East had, and we're talking always about average, because of course in the Near East there were certain cavalrymen that were as good as the Western ones. Simply in the West that was more widespread, as systemically speaking. So, but they maybe had something else, and war is asymmetric by definition, so there is always something you're gonna use in different ways. I don't know, take, in fact, the difficulties also this mounted elite had in countries that were, in fact, allegedly, you know, and not actually allegedly, just, but also they were kind of backwards, but I don't know, think about what Norman knights had to do to fight in Wales, for instance. Well, at that point, there are so many other factors that enter into play than the individual, you know, knight. And this is important to understand when looking at war. And also other common grips were the two-handed one, just like the old contos in back in the day, and this is even in the 13th century, and not much had changed, you know, also from the migration here. I think that the last dragons, dragon banners are seemingly still witnessed in 13th century Germany, as, you know, the idea is really with weapons and with military culture, everything is much more fluid and homogeneous in some ways than you can imagine. Now, how did cavalry charges practically work? Well, I also would need to dedicate a whole video about this. And I did talk about it, I don't remember which videos in medieval warfare playlist, I'm sure you will find something. It was not specifically about cavalry charges, but I discussed them at some point. So, as you know, many people think that there were real charges at full gallop, and that this is kind of not true. Full gallop was used, if anything, just to flee. First of all, if you're so overloaded in armor and so on, you don't go full gallop. You can't even go full gallop because the horse gets exhausted. But in the first place, it's something you don't even need to do because that would be uselessly exhausting. Usually, knights advanced very slowly in formation, also to keep the formation. Sometimes even for 100 of meters, it's also very important to understand what these battlefields looked like. Because, especially at the acme of cavalry combat, you know, these battlefields were very stretched, actually. It could be also kilometers long. So a thickly packed formation of some hundred of knights in kilometers is actually a pretty small thing. In space and on the surface of the battlefield. So these things worked. You see that, you know, these advanced very slowly. Then they began eventually when they went inside of the enemy. Usually they to go at this canter pace that is essentially between gallop and the slow pace. It's roughly something like between 40-45 kilometers per hour, and that's where they would impact. And this happened in the last like 100 meters, and this was done in fact to preserve till the very last moment as much unity, as much cohesion in the formation as possible. And this was crucial, and these last meters also were very important because there were certain knights who, you can imagine the anxiety. I had the luck to study a very beautiful text. And maybe that is the Steirische Reimchronik. That is one of the few texts that kind of gets much in deep because it was written actually by a, not a knight, but let's say a guy, no, I can't explain, was part of a knight family. And it's something relatively rare. And it really gives you, you know, also the emotional side of this thing. You know, just think what it means also from in the whole situation. These battles were fought in this corners in these places in Europe for which, I don't know, the campaign maybe had lasted months and months. And you basically arrived after these months of marches, of efforts, of minor clashes, to arrive at a big battle. The one everything had kind of, all the odds had kind of brought to, all the factors had made you arrive there. These big battles were also pretty rare, and every knight dreamed to fight in these battles because these knights had a very short life, usually. So instead of dying in your own, you know, rotten body after, you know, having just a small wounded infected for storming a shitty castle, mountain bailey fortress, but because maybe just a commoner had throw a crossbow at you, wouldn't it have been better to die in these major battles that, you know, decided the fate of kingdoms and that was the dream. To die, if they really have to die, to do it in a, you know, in a lordly way. Sadly for them, most of them died actually in these other occasions, but that was the ideal, that was the dream. And always remember that actually mortality in the combat was actually pretty low. As always, it was not the combat, it was mostly these infected wounds after a battle or even during the pursuit. Also knights tended not to kill each other, but just to capture each other and to be ransomed was much more valuable. But and especially with the rise of commoners' warfare, with the rise of infantries, of pole arms, of crossbows, you realize those commoners were targeting you and your horse just to kill you. So that's also a bit of a difference that starts happening towards the later part of this. And this is also why plate armor are usually, it's the spreading of crossbows that is commonly thought to have brought to such a, it was at least it was a major factor in the spreading of plate armor, but also in here, yeah, and it is kind of fine, but it's things that went kind of in parallel also with other changes, and that's what a bit what I was saying before is that objectively up to the 16th century every kind of weapon that existed out there was kind of effectively countered by armor, at least by elite armor. So for instance, you never find the the witness, I don't know, that a crossbow killed a guy that, that was wearing plate armor. I mean, unless he didn't open his visor, something you start finding mostly in the 14th century, telling the truth, and therefore the bolt struck in his face, well, that's one thing. But actually, it's very rare to say, you know, there were now weapons that were able to effectively have an impact and such thing. Usually the horses were more vulnerable because I've discussed this maybe in other videos in the medieval warfare playlist, because they, you know, already the knight armor was extremely expensive, and usually the knight was better defended than the horse, because horse armor was something enormously expensive, much more naturally than one of the knights. So at this point there were these padded coats and so on, but horses were very easy targets, especially for missile weapons. And in fact, in chivalric culture, let's say a knight that killed an, another knight's horse was kind of considered very you know, very moral. And also in here, I'm making a point because I believe that beyond the ideals, everything was much more unloyal than we can imagine in this battles of feudal, in the battlefields of feudal Europe. Actually, it was pretty normal also to do such kind of things. So, yeah, it is true that mortality was kind of low until, you know, the feudal elite kept fighting against feudal elite, other feudal elite. But first of all, whoever was not feudal elite was slaughtered. So usually also the infantrymen on foot were not armored, were on foot, were commoners, got slaughtered pretty easily. But nobody gave a damn about them. And so they're not even recorded by sources. But the let's say that this doesn't mean that these clashes were not bloody, or that were not deadly. As a matter of fact, at this time, a lot of tournaments took place, and in this period, the tournaments were not the jousts with the bench, with the, you know, everything was staged and so on. These tournaments were real battles, and I mean real battles, not simulated battles. I mean, these guys got bored and got meeting in one place to, you know, because these knights were actually bands of thugs, let's be honest about it. And they went into a place that was usually someone else's, maybe of some peasants in the countryside. I don't know, they had kind of broke their back all the day to plant the seeds, to cultivate everything. And these guys decided to fight in there, to make a mess, to destroy everything, to crush each other. And in during those tournaments, there was always someone who got killed among the knights. So it's actually, it was always a risky business. We know this, that teeth were broken, bones were broken, people died. So this happened, and it was all pretty violent. So also the idea that, yeah, mortality rates were rather low, it is true among knights, but still they were there, and they were extremely physical and violent things. If anything, consider the forces that are involved into a cavalry charge. Even if you charge theoretically against a guy at canter, a cavalry charge that goes 40 kilometers per hour, you go at 40 kilometers per hour, it's as if you smashed against someone at 80 kilometers per hour. And I say theoretically because, you know what, this never happened. Also, this idea that cavalry charges really existed as such, you know, as if, you know, these blocks of hundreds of men kind of charged one against the other at this sum of 80 kilometers per hour is fantasy. It never existed, obviously, because what are you going to kill yourself in that way? It doesn't work like that. Horses will not let you do it, by the way, because they don't want to crash against each other, and they won't. What these cavalry charges were meant to do was essentially to see who gave up first, in the sense that the cohesion at that point was all that mattered, and the horses are gonna avoid crashing one against the other. So actually it was about who was able to keep the greater cohesion up to the very last moment. And then there were naturally horsemen who clashed, who smashed one against the other, they did. But it mostly happened at an individual level, because the masses confronting each other, were able to kind of spot, you know, to understand who was more cohesive, and one would give way, practically. This is how it worked. It would lose cohesion progressively, maybe after several charges, because this is also how it worked. These knights were so highly trained, they could perform several charges at once, and this was very important because the ability in collective training was vital, exactly in here, because you had to clash for a few minutes against these guys, then fall back and reform, reline up. And if you were not trained enough, the guy could line up better first, have more time, and crash into you where you were still disordered, and you lost. And when you lost cohesion, when formation lost cohesion, you were done. Because you can't oppose yourself physically to that mass, to those muscles of men and horses, to that armor. And you gave way, and you're captured, and you're done. And that's how a defeat happened. Many were these crazies that, I don't know, wanted to show their courage, their boldness. This happened at all times during feudal times, for which, I don't know, maybe even a single knight, we have evidence, I've just read in some sources about this, that completely alone, completely out of the blue, they charged alone against the wall enemy, just to get butchered down most of the times. But because it was also this idea of competition, of bravery, of having, especially in these battles, everybody would know actually how you behaved on that occasion, because it was just the news today. Everybody wanted, and these were the big news, they were big things, and if you had been a coward, you were, you know, everybody was ashamed of you, and you were, that would haunt for all your life. So also this act of literal madness, of individualistic prowess and so on, were sometimes happening. So you could see actually many times these formations of horsemen didn't actually even perform these charges so often. Sometimes, because you have to consider the greater charge was kind of carried out mostly in these big battles, but most of warfare was actually something very different. There were a few cavalrymen also kind of testing each other formation. This was what warfare was in a nutshell. You had to test the cohesion of the enemy ranks and hit where it was weaker, and do it over and over again. And this could entail several charges, several feint flights, several, you know, trying to come closer and then retreating. So this was constantly like that. This was done also with infantry. You know, before an army of knights charged, I don't know, certain armies of commoners, they would come in front of them, they would sometimes even circle around them, they would look, try to spot the weaker part of the line, to know, look, we have to charge into that. And naturally, in the meanwhile, according to the, you know, the direction the knights moved, within the ranks, there would be men of the infantry, there would be men shifting, you know, according to the direction to kind of reinforce that section of the line. This is what warfare really was about, and everything was way more progressive. Sometimes there were kind of these kamikaze knights were kind of more, I mean, you don't hear it much in the sources, but there was sometimes the elite of the elite. There were certain knights that were chosen, essentially they were ultra-armored and were kind of the best, and that they were meant to, they were usually just a shock. This is the name of the unit that is, you find also in the sources, a shock that was to do exactly that. It wasn't even meant to charge en masse, but just to hit kind of surgically into a certain point of the line, or maybe kind of luring the enemy towards a certain direction to make him lose cohesion towards one side, because they had this very high specific weight, this very high penetration potential. And this is what really this warfare was about. So charges actually is this thing of, you know, hundreds of men smashing at that speed. It's something unrealistic. It really never happened. Was these guys kind of doing back and forth every once in a while, someone charging, you know, a couple of guys charging into that point of the line because they had, look, it was weaker and so on, time after time, until one of the two sides didn't give way because they were either exhausted, they were usually exhausted psychophysically speaking. this was in a nutshell how it happened. And when the guys would impact, naturally would fall the melee. Also, the sources in also certain studies you find that, you know, this is where the so-called confused melee started. This is not really true. There is, obviously confusion is present always on a battlefield. You never had a formation that is always perfectly in shape. This is also realistic. But the idea that the melee is confused and that this, especially in the Middle Ages, that there is a stereotype that, I don't know, after the charge, everything degenerated into this huge, confused individual fights that had no cohesion. This is simply false, because this is not how humans fight in every time in history, because that's always the same thing. First of all, humans always stick together. Humans feel comforted by having someone close. If they get out of the group, they're lost. So they always fight with a certain degree of cohesion, and the idea of the individual fight was just something that is emphasized sometimes by the sources, because at this time these guys were obsessed with the epics, you know, the idea that it was one versus one, you know, this reminiscence of the heroic times that never existed, because also back in the day, I don't know, in the Bronze Age, in the Iron Age, it was never objectively... There were duels sometimes, there were staged, but in actual warfare, these champions were always followed by someone else. So, feudal Europe still retained pretty much this kind of ethos, of individualistic ethos, as we have seen. But this was celebrated in literature, in, you know, in this epics, in this chivalric ideals, in poetry and so on, but just ideally. The reality of warfare was very, very different, and there was no such a thing as an extremely confused melee into which you couldn't see who was who in practice. Everybody tended to stick together, even on horseback. This didn't really change much from cavalry into infantry at all. And at this time, however, at close range, you don't fight with a lance, at least not necessarily, but you would prefer the secondary weapon that is, as we know, all either sword, that is kind of probably the greatest symbol of the medieval knight. The sword had huge, it was overloaded with meanings of religious / magical nature. A sword was also an extremely expensive weapon at the time. There was a lot of economy revolving around its production. There were also other secondary weapons like maces. Maces were very important because they had this blunt effect. So swords actually rarely were able to even to breach into mail. A lynx, you know, at speed could pierce through mail to cause internal traumas and so on. The sword was not meant like that. And in fact, the coat of mail was historically, you know, not just in the Middle Ages, also before, mostly conceived to stop cutting weapons. Also because, as we've seen, cuts could get extremely easily infected, so it's something you wanted to prevent. And piercing was very hard, mail was very thick. So these blunt weapons like maces, but also axes, were actually used in many various shapes and sizes, could be found in use. And these were preferred. Also, the mace was in many ways, in every feudal context, kind of a noble weapon, in the sense that in order to approach an enemy with a mace, you have to be preferably very heavily armored as well, because, you know, you're gonna get in close range with that, and so you need also to be better armed. In fact, the major commoner's weapon was the pole arm, as they pole arms keep you a distance from the enemy, because you're not also armored enough. Instead, it was normal for a knight, and this is extremely evident, especially in the late Middle Ages, where there is a full plate armor, for which knights even abandoned shields, because the shield at this point, especially towards 13th century, is getting smaller. Why is it getting smaller? Because the armor is getting stronger, essentially. So you don't need that anymore. So you see, also in late Middle Ages, maces, polar, and blunt weapons of various sorts were pretty much a knight's weapon, and so it was a bit like at this time. Although the sword would be kind of the most, the most widespread weapon, also because most of the fighters on the battlefield were not armored. So, actually, the knights were sometimes equipped with weapons that are usually thought to have been some commoner weapons. For instance, the falchions were, say, oh, the falchion is something comes from, the agricultural tools or something like that, and it's mostly a commoner's weapon. No, actually, there are representations of knights armed with falchions that could use them effectively against unarmored opponents, the falchions. Now, I'm sure here in the background I'm putting some pictures from the Maciejowski Bible that shows also this kind of fictitious thing of falchions cutting through mail, or even plate like into one of the helmets. But this is kind of fantasy. It's a bit of science of the time. But these cutting weapons, including the sword, but also this kind of other blades that we've seen, were used by knights to cut through this bunch of unarmored commoners, and the knights could do it because they could get a close range, being very, very well armored and kind of being immune to, actually almost immune to most, actually not to most weapons, but let's say that they had having a very high degree of protection also for fighting at close range. Excuse me, I drink a little bit again. There is an evolution naturally in weaponry. For instance, towards the second half of the 13th century, it seems that in France and in Italy there were there was this spread of shorter swords, kind of daggers, and these were essentially meant now to pierce through the plate armor that was beginning to spread at that time. This is especially during the Battle of Benevent in 1266. There is this kind of French versus Germans in southern Italy, and for this battle we have the witness of the Angevin knights essentially not able to effectively fight against the Germans, who were particularly armored, seemingly. They recurred to these stalks, so actually getting very physically, even at close range, even hugging, literally embracing the opponents and trying to stab them with these stalks practically into their armpits, into their neck, or the places where they were less armored, presumably. This is important actually because it leads a bit to talk about what the German equipment was at the time. Was a bit different. I made a video on the origins of plate armor into Western Europe during the 13th century, which is essentially a German story at that point, because Germany is the country where plate armor appears for the first time. Then eventually, it's not that Germany had such an extraordinary different, absolutely not, but it's because eventually plate armor would spread in a few years all over Europe pretty homogeneously. But the question was why in Germany, and there are many many answers. We don't really know, because we know so many things in detail, but sometimes the bigger questions are going to necessarily remain unanswered because nobody actually knows. We don't have enough evidence to prove it. If you meet someone who has figured it out, most likely is lying, because there is no way to explain it given our data. Can make hypotheses, one better than others, but they remain hypotheses. The video I'm talking about is called, if you're interested in looking at these reasons, Origins of Western Coat of Plates, second half of the 13th century, and that deals with this German armor. But another thing what the Germans were famous for were was actually their swords. The French called them the Grande Épée d'Allemagne, the Great Swords of Germany, because it's seemingly the Germans had kind of, and we have actual evidence of this, archaeologically, documentaries, they had longer swords, bigger swords. Sometimes they preferred this size augmented, not because, you know, Germans might have been, I don't know, bigger on average than the other Europeans up to a certain point, but, you know, it's kind of virtually ineffluent. But they kind of change in function, actually. You know, their size was functional also to other things. In fact, the Germans preferred at this point actually 1.5 swords, and, you know, the double-handed swords basically appear in the very, I think, in the very last decade of the 13th century. Also in here, they began to appear very likely also to shatter, to be bigger weapons to shatter also this coat of plates that were being formed eventually. You see it, that the double-hand sword is very spread also towards the end of the Middle Ages for these very heavily armored guys. But the Germans seemingly had this bigger swords with a 1.5 hand grip. We don't actually know why it was the case. Many people, there are certain hypotheses. My favorite one, I mean, all are equally valuable. Even the thing that the Germans might have been bigger, it's possible, because objectively swords at this point were not standardized, so they were often built on the size of the fighter. So it's obviously that the bigger you were in the, you know, the bigger your sword was in the first place, and that's also, that's valid for every kind of weapon. That's why longbowmen usually were, you know, it's not that the longbow is a particular type of weapon, it's just a longer bow than the other, and this was used naturally by people who were physically tougher, bigger. And because it's always been so, the weapon adapted to the strength of the user. Then eventually during the 14th century, it's the Kingdom of England that issues this, you know, longbows, kind of selecting also certain human material, so that there was also more, the crown paid people for training for a longer time. So in that case, there was also a bit of a artificially thing, but let's say that this bigger size weapon were common throughout all history, naturally speaking, because bigger people would use bigger weapons. But in the case of the Germans, it's not, you know, if you look at the anthropometric data, it's not that the Germans were enormously bigger than other people. So there must be another factor. Also because you don't find it in Scandinavia, for instance. So it's not that the Germans were taller than the Scandinavians. So that's not the point. That's not the point. It might have had something to do with it, but, you know, minimally. The other point is what we were talking about before, that is the particular nature of the German environment, especially before the full spread of feudalism into Germany, that entailed actually a higher degree of infantry of foot combat. Because of the nature of Germany, that we have seen was kind of a mess in terms of forests, swamps, and other very few suitable terrain for cavalry operation. So the idea, for instance, is that on horseback, you need a sword that is not excessively big. For instance, you can't use two-hand sword on horseback. You can use a 1.5 sword in some way, but mostly you know it's a bit more difficult. So what would be kind of natural is that if these guys had to fight dismounted, especially sometimes against our cavalry, maybe they needed kind of bigger swords, given that they were elite. You know, in the other countries, this elite, you know, Germany was also rather poor this time, underdeveloped, especially, you know, aside if you take out the Rhineland and the southern Germany, you know, the rest of Germany was pretty wild, actually. But was still an elite, and this elite fought on foot. So one of the reasons, which is not actually, because there were similar contexts also in the rest of Europe, but I don't know, perhaps it's just this hybrid nature, a bit between feudalism and about a bit this more kind of more primitive Germanic environment that might have, you know, make the Germans prefer to fight dismounted and with these larger swords. Then in this sense were used a bit not just like with swords, but a bit also like anti-horse weapon. And we actually are pretty full of evidence, even since the 11th century. Think about the Battle of Civitate against the Normans, these mercenaries in papal service in southern Italy. They were all saying that these guys traditionally fought dismounted and with these bigger weapons. So these things are kind of, it's as if they were always necessarily paired, and in my opinion that is a good reason to explain why. Because in other countries in Europe, there were equally these primitive conditions of Germany, but Germany was slowly, you know, also feudalizing in part, so it was a bit of an hybrid nature. So it's this factor that maybe in other areas of Europe didn't quite happen in the same way that brought to it. Also, this is a kind of a very approximate answer, and we don't really know, but indeed, the connection dismounted, one and a half sword is kind of makes sense thinking at how infantry warfare was developed among the nobility in Germany at this point. And it can provide kind of an answer towards this direction. So, and eventually, towards the end of the 13th century, feudal Europe gets practically fully homogenized. So, So the Germans at this point kind of are indistinguishable from this point of view. Maybe, yeah, the Germany maintains a bit more of a this great helm, this heavier equipment. We don't really know why. Also, in there we should look a bit closer at the matter. Consider that Germany has always been, differently from other areas, kind of an area of frontier. I mean, you'd never quite understood, especially on the eastern frontier where Germany stopped. And the Germans had always to deal with this kind of threats from the east. It was a very militarized world in many ways. So it might be that there were certain factors that brought especially the individual knight to be a kind of more multitask, more, you know, kind of because there were not many other resources to invest in terms of while the Angevins, for instance, France at this point was kind of differentiating somewhat in also in tactically speaking, you know, southwestern Europe at this time was seeing also for other reasons that maybe it's a bit of a climatic reason, but also partly maybe this greater wealth that allowed more specialization, perhaps, that there is a greater tactical variety of troops. Germany seems more homogeneous, maybe starting to develop, especially in 14th century, these mounted crossbowmen that appear prominently in the sources, but having this heavily armored knights with these great helms and this plate armor kind of appearing and developing earlier. But for the rest, also Germany is pretty homogeneous to all the other areas of Western Europe, and their warfare was completely similar to the ones of any other country in that area. You know, also this idea, you know, if you take Italy, for instance, the Italians had a very few iron on their own. So, for instance, they were developing kind of armor that was, you know, boiled leather is actually can be also, it was toughened with some resins, whatever stuff. It could get extremely hard. And that is lighter, that is cheaper than armor, of course. And it's also more, you know, it's easier. You know, just think of fighting, I don't know, in July in Italy or in Spain, in southern France, you know, it gets really tough with metal armor on. You know, and these are also factors that we have to realize. Sometimes, also we don't have to think knights in this context were all equipped in the same way. A knight might have his own armor but not wearing it because it was too hot. Actually, we have plenty of evidence of this in warfare. And sometimes even this fresher condition and even lighter equipment could be paradoxically even more functional, because it could make the knight tire less easily, I mean less more slowly, and also to be more mobile and so on. So actually it's interesting to look at these kind of specializations that start to appear towards the end of the 13th century and will kind of increase more during the later Middle Ages. But this is also another topic. It's partly also not just my speculation, telling the truth, but there is substance to it, and we can't stop now, but I think it was worth the mention at least. So as I'm saying, this is an introductory video, so I promise I will touch these topics individually in the future in greater detail and with less approximation. So how many units of cavalry actually fought? Well, first of all, there were many ways these units were called. The main term was definitely acies in Latin, which means essentially a rank. I've never found in other languages there is a proper term to define, you know, this rank meant as a formation, as a unit, that acies is supposed to mean. In French, that also was the, after Latin, the second most important language in military affairs at this time. It influenced massively both many countries, including Germany and Italy and England, of course, was bataille, so battles. So these were the main units, and these were would be a kind of, I don't even know how to qualify that in terms of, it would be companies practically, and these would remain essentially as the main tactical unit. They could be made up of a couple of hundreds, considering these couple of hundreds being mostly lighter cavalry, and you know, the mounted elite being actually the armored elite being much less. Usually this battalion were also split into other squadrons, usually two. This was usually the thing. They were essentially company size units that were divided in two for achieving more flexibility, something you find in many other armies and company level in history. Each half with its own officer. In Germany was called, they were called masters of cavalry, and they always led from the front, because from the front they had also this, even during the advance, they rode back and forth to see if everything was in line, and shouting the guy to remain in line, to remain, because you have to think, during the charge, many people freaked out. They were extremely anxious, they were frightened, and in order to vent the tension, they just charged a full gallop straight ahead, so distancing themselves from the others, and compromising the unity of the wall formation, the cohesion of the wall formation, so that it was extremely risky. And these masters of cavalry, Rottmeister in German, that was what it called, were there. These were these were veterans. Grizzled veterans that were there, that had seen it all before, and were keeping especially the younger that were joining now, that were freaking out in two line to make the formation stay. It was very important, because you have to imagine also this generational replacement that happened at every season, you can argue, because these people fought every year, so every year it was someone who had died and someone else who was joining, especially the younger. So there was this also this the unit had to give this discipline, this had to teach how to behave, how to fight information, because it's very easy to be an individual skilled person, especially when you're younger, you feel so strong, you feel so you want to do many things. Well, one thing is to use your brain, that's something you start doing better later, and that's brain here more than muscles, so that really make the difference. So these were the bataille, and they usually were, you know, there were usually three the three divisions, we can call them. It was usually three, and there were other numbers actually, but the three was a very good number to maintain, you know, a certain degree of flexibility to carry out this progressive effort, but also not to overcomplicate the tactics, because the more you split the army, the more difficult it is to coordinate, so you have to keep it simple. And three was a good number, and it's also usually they corresponded to battle lines practically, so and there was practically no more than three, as far as I can remember in this phase. So everything, naturally you can imagine all the combinations, because this all, every single archers was kind of different in nature. They could come from other places, they could be, you know, also of higher or lesser quality, so, you know. Initially they were made up by feudal contingents, in the later times, and this were mostly mercenaries, and also here it's difficult to distinguish, because sometimes mercenaries were noblemen as well. And how deep were these units on the battlefield? Were it's not very clear, because the sources do not tell us much, but usually they were probably no more than, actually, if you especially if you're talking about the heavy cavalry, they weren't probably more than two or three ranks deep. There would be other ranks made up of other troops, lighter troops, the squires, or less armored cavalry was there for some reason, and these were meant to support, to back up the heavier knights during combat. So for the wall formation, 3-5 ranks is fine. The idea is also when you charge, you don't need to have several ranks deep, because you're not an infantry formation that has to press each other. You know, the cavalry is well used if it has this. Of course, psychologically speaking, have a deeper unit is kind of saying, oh my god, they're coming all at us, but actually during the charge it would be just the very first line we would run into the enemy, because the others would otherwise crush into them, and crushing not on the enemy but on the backs of their fellow comrades. So that was not the point, even though the mass is very important, because it scares the hell of people. In fact, as we were saying before, the main effect of this is also like the ABC of cavalry warfare. It's not cavalry warfare is not the shock of cavalry warfare doesn't lay in the physical impact, it lays in the psychological impact. Humans are terrified by observing these knights approaching, and that's all it is about, really. Sometimes, in fact, this is my idea, is that they approach very close, they charge all together, but in last meters it was actually only the first line that charged, and we also have evidence of knights charging also, of these knight formations charging also with one rank deep. Also for other reasons, also cultural reasons, because the idea is that the guy that is in the front is superior inherently to the guy who comes second, in the second rank. So that's why the squires were behind, because it was a matter of pride. If you're a nobleman, you want to be in the first line, because the world society has created you as a knight to perform that task, and if you don't, you have failed. You have failed like an individual. So a lot of problem in feudal warfare was related exactly to this. I mean, to the idea that nobody had to come second to the others, and this caused also big problem to discipline, because also timing was fundamental in cavalry charges. Think about the Battle of Arsuf with Richard Lionheart against the Egyptians. That was a moment of great timing, great head, but there were many noblemen that wanted essentially to outclass the king by basically charging first and getting the honor of breaking the first spear. This is kind of a kind of the reality. So as we were saying, you know, these second ranks of squires or mounted sergeants that were, you know, in back or intermixed with the knights would provide new lances between one charger and another. I would bring to drink to their masters and so on. Also because lances, for instance, broke during the impact, so they had there were several charges during the fight. So there had to be these even spare horses. Usually the wealth of a knight was measured also in the amount of horses that he could bring with him. So did you realize, especially during later times in the late Middle Ages, that you see these lances, say these were this tactical unit that, you know, had several horses with, and sometimes even four horses with, that was an ultra elite, I don't know, by the 14th century. Some of these horses were naturally also mounted by other assistants that were fighting, and also there were different types of horses, because the, you know, the stallion was the heavier horse. It was also slower, but it had this bigger muscle, so it could give this greater force into those, into that small moment, that brief moment of the charge, but then couldn't run very much. Actually, most of the horses that were mounted by the knights were kind of a halfway. They were the runners, and this could allow also to flee, for instance, which is was considered as shame, but in practice was done. So that's also why the ultra elite was conceived also to fight to the death, because very often they arrived at the very end, you know, they entered into the fight at the very end of the battle to turn the tides, to make it, to win the battle. There were this usually also the political elite, so those were more committed into that battle, who had more to lose when lost, and they were mounting stallions who couldn't run away, as the enemy usually had lighter cavalry swarming around in the lines, ready to run after the enemy once it broke down. So that's why also these guys fought to the death, because with all their heavier equipment, their heavy horses, they couldn't much run away. And also thought they would be preferably captured and ransomed rather than actually killed, but this, you know, they were also killed sometimes. And sometimes you also find, also in the more, this depended really on the tactical situation, could vary so much, that you find sergeants, so these kind of lighter troops, lighter cavalry placed in the front. So maybe to soften up the enemy ranks, it is perfectly normal. Actually, if you want especially to tire the enemy, you will use in the first battles the lighter troops, and then you leave the cream, the heavier, the elite, for the last clash. This happened, especially this is kind of warfare, the kind of tactics that were developing consistently during the 13th century, when especially these battles were increasingly more staged, and they needed more, also because feudal powers were getting stronger, so they could field these larger armies that were also quite difficult to use. So sometimes even these chivalric edicts that conceived the idea of meeting, of the two armies meeting in one place and having this chivalrous fight, one, you know, one in front of the other, was not actually due to loyalty, because the 13th century is actually the same century in which this there is the ambush that is developed as very intense tactics, very unloyal for chivalric standards. But it was because it was difficult to even get to the fight with all of these troops. And think about, you know, for a single knight you have lots of other people who have to follow, who have to prepare the camp, who have to feed the horse, who have to be fed at the same time. So a huge baggage train. These are the problems that are being developed at this point. And the sometimes cavalry charges were led not at a straight angle, but, you know, a bit more in an oblique fashion. This happened. It's not that there are actually intrinsic advantages of doing this. I mean, it's not, you know, oblique tactics famously from the ancient world and also to think about Frederick II. It's something that people are oblique tactics. You win everything with oblique tactics. Actually, not. It really depends what kind of enemy, what kind of tactical circumstance. And the point why oblique tactics was, I mean, at least how this cavalry battles would actually perform this thing, was usually a bit different than this, because it was used either to kind of try to make the enemy formation wield, I mean to follow that direction to meet that first contact, or because actually the same, your own battle line was segmented in a way that, you know, the best guys were more on one side, and you couldn't practically, you know, you relied more on them for the first impact. Mm-hmm. Because the idea, you know, there is no intrinsic reason to make this sequence of charges on the battle line by attacking obliquely or doing it all once again. Actually, from a sheer geometrical point of view, which is completely theoretical, you know, the second one is more effective because you hit all at once. So you achieve this greater immediate impact, homogeneous shock all at once. But this could happen in many ways. It was much less, you know, fluid, you have to imagine. This could happen in very slow ways, in very, you know, a tiny shock units trying that first. You know, it was not this scenographical thing that happened all at once, usually. So another thing, before the charge, actually the knights, especially towards the end of this period when the Great Helm was being developed, actually put their helmets on only before the last 75-100 meters. Also because these Great Helms were difficult for breathing. And at that point, the order was launched, fatally. This was the thing, the norm was poignet, which means to spur. Spur the horse, or Helm auf, or Reit so in German. These were the things, so the guys would put the helm on and would charge. And this was the moment of, you know, you can't really imagine that even the spectacular sight of these guys charging all together and shouting and, you know, making this great effort, this impact. So, there were, I don't know what I could say now, because, you know, how does an army rout is something, also in here it would be interesting to explain. Actually, the rout is something that starts very progressively. You can't argue that in every battle there's always someone who exists till the very end to provide the others to flee. It's something extremely widespread in military history, because formations are not homogeneous, the composition is not homogeneous, it's plenty of different elements who have all the different reasons to remain, to fight, to flee, and so on. Also, this idea, in fact, of it often happens, you know, in these sources to find certain nuclei of troops that, even when the army was fleeing, were keeping to fight till the end. This is normal, and it happens in many times. It happened both. Usually, at this point, these troops were dismounted, preferably. If they really were to do it, this was also a matter of honor. There are many, you know, fanatically loyal troops that could even flee on their horses, but they wouldn't because they wanted to fight till the very end with their masters, with their kings, and they did. And defending them to the death. Individual heroism has no limits. It's boundless, actually. And so that really depends on the person. There is no even kind of systemic factor. You can't say an army is more courageous than another. It really depends on so many elements, and also these large bodies of men act, you know, collectively in very kind of different ways, also from what the individual will, than what the individual will of the single is. Another thing related to this is the feigned flight. You know, the idea that in several battles at this time, especially during the the 11th, in the beginning of 12th century, there is a lot of feint flights, seemingly. And these are very controversial point, because this is, first of all, a very early age. And the sources do not help us a great deal to understand what battles were like. The sources are very, you know, it's very difficult to reconstruct a medieval battle objectively. Looking, even when they're well documented, there is no organic attention for the tactical development of the battle. In my opinion, it is possible that systemically speaking, especially in this time where infantry was still a thing, could still, counter, and could still withstand an enemy, a cavalry charge. This idea of retreating, of saying, okay, we're not going to make it against this wall of spears and shields, let's retreat, is plausible. Hastings is kind of the best example of this. You know, when the Normans kind of had softened up the Saxon shield wall with arrows, and they had tried to charge into it with cavalry. They don't make it. Then from the sources, we don't understand whether the Normans kind of made a feint flight, or they were actually routing. There is literally no way to say it, and I would say, however, most of the times, these were real routes. So it was perfectly feasible, and also throughout all this history, too, that cavalry would regroup after having been routed. This happened many, many times, also in some of the most important battles. It happened one time when unit was routed, then it reformed and came back to battle. Actually, it was not excessively frequent, but it still could happen. And the idea, especially when you had different ranks that were scattered, that were put deployed in depth, arrayed in depth, it was that, you know, since these battles were meant to be prolonged over time, to have this progressive effort, and the battles lasted hours. And the idea is that if, I don't know, the first battle is routed, theoretically can can take refuge behind the wall army and to reform and to go into battle. This was pretty normal. And naturally it's difficult to control a formation that is routed, because most of the times it's, you know, especially if they're not trained troops, they will probably fly, you know, they will probably flee without. But when talking about this mounted elite, these guys, as we've seen, were extremely highly trained, very highly trained. So they would tendentially be able to regroup, to reform, and to line up once again for another charge. So the fact that this ceased to seemingly into later times, I don't know how true this really is. And I won't give further thoughts about this now, but I found it written, so I wanted to comment it a little bit. The idea is, well, whatever, this, let's stop it in this way. So talking about the deployment, as we have seen, there were actually infinite ways you could deploy your army. Because every army is different, every battlefield is different, so you're always deploying a different way. However, the major options were called en aile, which a French term says in line, essentially, or successive line, one next to the other. So no formation in depth, but a unique battle line that was theoretically preferred, but in my opinion was less frequent than it's often thought. More frequently, an echelon. So an echelon, with one flank advanced, usually the left one, and the other refused. Then there was also the column. As we've seen, these were practically used. I know if the battlefield was narrow, for instance, you would preferably deploy in column. Also, this idea of having your flanks protected is something good. The armies were searching for it. So this idea, the ideal fight in chivalric, in this chivalric idea was having everybody in the face of the other without sneaky things. But as a matter of fact, ambushes, of these concealed shocks, elite units hidden in the forest or in a ballet, were actually being used very, especially in the 13th century. It's seemingly something that the Europeans brought from the East, but they were also developing, in my opinion, for... This is not really a good interpretation. They were doing it because cavalry was getting kind of more coordinated and they could carry out such a force. Just remember that even if a very few cavalrymen can destroy a wall battle if they hit in the right place. We have the evidence of units of hundreds that were destroyed by units of tens just because they attacked them on their flank, they fell on their flank or their rear. So once you break a formation in two, they're done. And it's all about the cohesion and the formation throughout the whole fight. The rest doesn't matter. It's also very psychological, but it could be also very physical. You know, really cutting into one rank is something you can do, especially with an elite chosen shock. As that unit was also called. And the echelon is a bit and a halfway between the two options because it's still, you know, it can still allow a progressive effort, but you still have room for maneuvering. So you leave yourself option open the option to carry out flank attacks. I made a video on the Battle of Ramla. The third battle of Ramla during the Crusades. If you go into Crusades playlist or medieval warfare playlist, you find it. And that was a typical and a very beautiful example of echelon formation used by the Crusaders with a Muslim army that was instead deployed in line. And that gives you the idea of how those attacks were conducted. So, what else can we say about this? Yes, these concealed forces kind of start appearing. Actually, they were used also before. I think the Battle of Tenkebray in 1206 was used. These tactics were all there. You see it at the battle, especially in the 13th century. You see it at the Battle of Muret by Simon de Montfort, by his nephew at the Battle of Lincoln Fair. Then the Battle of Bouvines. This happened on a smaller scale on a flank. The French carried it out. The Battle of Tagliacozzo in 1268. The Battle of Marcfeld 1278. These all battles were such concealed troops actually made the difference because they attacked the enemy on the rear. And this was considered very unchivalrous. It's very interesting to notice also in the contemporary historiography that is concealed. You know, during the battle, the sources of the side who won didn't mention. They tried to conceal the fact that they had won with this unloyal way. So it was probably done much more frequently than we know, also thanks to this this concealment. But it was still considered pretty sneaky and pretty cowardly to do. And yet it was very effective, and in fact it was used. Like most of the times in history, even if it's something is bad, If it works, people are still going to use it. So it's really a matter of cost benefits, and that's how certain individuals and how certain generals and commanders in these battles won entire kingdoms. So you would do it for a kingdom, come on. Okay. Okay, there are many other things now that... there is the pig snout formation as well, the swine formation, also known in old Scandinavian as Svinfylking. Sorry for my pronunciation sucks. And it was used chiefly, it seems, in Northern Europe and also in Russia. And this was a formation that could actually be used both by infantry and cavalry, and the idea is basically having the cavalry making up the snout with infantry and or light cavalry behind them. It similarly was used by the Teutonic Knights at the Lake Peipus battle in 1242, also by other troops, but actually if you look at you know, this wedge array is, it was something very common. Sometimes the sources do not say it explicitly, but most of these units were actually deployed in triangles. This is also a bit for the same reasons we mentioned before, relatively to these elite shocks of troops, you know, how they had to be used. Naturally, this triangular shape is evident. You know, the idea is that you have like the point of a diamond, that is the toughest, the hardest. And in, although it's not really a physical concept like that, because the diamond point has a, you know, a structure on its own that is not flexible, the unit is. So the reason why this was done was actually not concentrating the force of all the people who came behind, but really, because this is what people think, you know, if you have a wedge formation, the point is that you somewhat concentrate more strength on that point. Is it true? Of course it's not. It's not true. The point is, you have, you know, if you really had an elite that could pierce, that could smash into a formation, the best thing you can do is to deploy it in line. So the idea is you hit the enemy with that equal strength and it's done. Especially with cavalry, first of all, you can't push from the behind. It's not like with infantry, you can exploit the muscular force of the people who crush you from the behind. So it sounds bad, I know, but that's how it happened. And that smashed against, you know, that pressed like a bunch of football players one against the others, because you can't keep on your feet. On horseback, you can't do that. So the reason why this pig snout, this wedge formation was used is that, you know, the idea was to concentrate the very elite, there was a very few men actually, not the wall triangle, not the wall wedge, to hit on that specific weak point of deformation of the enemy that was spotted as such, and then to have this, all this mass of men coming behind, like exploiting immediately the breach into the enemy formation you had hopefully created. So not to give the enemy the time to reform or to surround that enemy or that guy who had made it through, and on the contrary to push you know, within the formation and to progressively divide it. It's not, people say, oh wow, they use this wedge formation, it's invincible. Yeah, no, it's not invincible. It's something you can do in certain situations. If it is convenient, it might not be convenient. And you can't do it all the time. It was preferred probably practically for this reason, actually. And this tells that not that it was like the wall force of the guys were running into them. It's really about all the guys who represent the point of this triangle, or this wedge, that makes the difference. Then all the others, if the guys at the top fail, they're screwed on their own. So it's this is, in my opinion, how it really worked, because otherwise there is no inherent advantage in doing, in having such a formation for any other reason. You would prefer to charge equally on the enemy line, but this is also theoretical, because in fact you want to concentrate that very elite on a single point, because it can be more effective, and then the others have to follow. So this is what White was so very well used. In telling the truth, you see that by the beginning of the 14th century, this tactic seems to kind of be, not to be lost in use, but kind of to be less frequent. Probably, I don't know really why, but perhaps because of an increase of professionalism, also there is a much greater degree of field fortification progressively, so warfare becomes more, let's say, perhaps less tactically dynamic in terms, especially at the level of unit, of formation. Perhaps it was not about more maneuvering and having this muscle to muscle, but it was just about attrition more. So this is probably the reason why this wedge formation is kind of more abandoned, because the problem there was not even fighting, crashing against formation, it was also crashing against ditches, entrenchments and so on. And you would do other things at that point. You would act differently. But nevertheless, it was very. And these wedges could be really big sometimes. They could host hundreds, if not more. In the Viking Age, there is the witness of thousands in there. So
Especially with infantry, you can't hope to press hard, especially with that point. But cavalry, not excessively much. It's really about the courage of the guy at the top and the ones who follow immediately and then the others. And this is normal, because every unit is segmented in that way. You have to think every unit, and then especially in these times, in history and ancient modern times, ancient medieval times, were kind of all segmented. There was no real, the guys in the front were usually the toughest one, the best equipped, the best trained, and the others were joining to make mass, also to scare the enemy. Sometimes in these units, in the rear, in the last ranks, people would be even unarmored or even disarmed, because they just had to show that they were there, but they were just betting everything on the guys in the front rank to do something about the whole situation, and they maybe didn't even have weapons on their own. Talking about and this is important because every unit is kind of, you can't, there are people I've seen even on the internet that there are certain viral videos that show, in this schools of reenactment and this hymn, I think, guys changing suddenly front, by just switching direction. As if you have a line of two ranks, and this change front by just turning 180 degrees, and that's done. That's not how that doesn't mean anything. Units do not work in that way, because in the unit there is always this kind of hierarchy. The guys are trained to follow the guys in the front. If you change suddenly direction, you're not gonna make the unit functional anymore, because they change direction. You have people in front of you that you're not more used to rely. So those are theoretical amenities that really do not mean anything in strictly military terms. And that's why the composition of the unit was something extremely important to do. The officers, the NCOs would have this great wisdom to deploy men, knowing them personally, knowing what their capabilities were, giving them that specific place in the unit, and relying on them in this sense. And it was arguably one of the most important. This happened when the army was deployed before battle. It took some time as well. And it was crucial, because you can't make a unit objectively, move however they like, hoping that they will keep cohesion, they will always be able to fight from the same direction. A unit has one direction, usually. Just this ultra-elite professional troops can kind of mount up, but in a more or less pre-arranged fashion, an assault and so on. But even then, there is this internal segmentation. And if you don't respect it, because the unit is broken, they're not going to be effective as a formation. And that's why collective training was so important, because between these charges, the main thing was to keep, to line up in the same fashion as quickly as possible, not lining up, randomly, whoever it was there just to form that shape, but lining up in the order they were, in the internal order that was functional to that unit to operate. So it doesn't, also the battlefield is usually, oriented, let's say, as in terms of, the armies are oriented on the battlefield in a certain way. If you are, that's the point, if you are surprised by an enemy who is following you on from a concealed position, you can't just turn and fight. You can do it, it was done, but at that point the unit is lost, because it's not meant to fight from that direction, especially if it's a multiple direction. But even if it isn't, it's a single one, and still you are attacked from a side you're not arranged for meeting the enemy for. You're done. So these guys just changing side, like is seen in movies or in this other, strange things that are on the internet. That's not historical. That's not how a unit works. Because it's all about the formation. It's not about individuals. It's all about the formation. and you have to imagine in this sense retainers, even civilians would join actually these units to show that there was mass, and that was done actually for psychological reasons more than else, and to strengthen the unit, to boost their morale with this presence. But you know, that's all they could do. So as we were saying before, there were many. This was a bit the differentiation. This idea that the French were better horsemen, the Germans were better infantrymen on average. It is true, as we've seen. But for the rest, these were you don't have to stress it too much. They were capable essentially of doing the same things. Also in here, all it mattered in how many men they could put together and how they were trained to fight in formation. That's the point in time, and there was this idea that ideally, in fact, the knight would be good as 10 infantrymen, 10 commoners. This was the idea. Breton says in by 1120 roughly that that a knight was also 7 times more effective mounted than dismounted. That is also a bit theoretical. It obviously depends on many factors, on the ground, the terrain, but it can also give the idea of the psychological edge that also mounted combat entailed in this sense. William of Apulia, describing the Battle of Civitate that in 1253, talking about those German mercenaries in the Papal army that eventually got slaughtered by the Normans, said that they were better with the sword than the lance, since they are incapable of handling their horses or thrusting vigorously with the lance. But they excel with the sword. During the Second Crusade, William of Tyre, you know, at Damascus, says that it was the custom of the Germans, when the circumstance obliged them to use it, to dismount, to charge. This is kind of strange, but that is also was done, you know, objectively also. This is a bit of maybe an exaggeration, but kind of makes sense sometimes, depending also what the terrain is. Here it's being said as if it was a national characteristic, and in my opinion it's a bit of an approximation to substantially say that the Germans were kind of more used to fighting on, you know, here we are in the 12th century, even before the Barbarossa became king, so that thing of the feudalism that was less developed in Germany might have actually been the cause of such a statement. Infantry, talking about infantry, the idea, as we've said before, is infantry this time was largely subservient to infantry, to cavalry, sorry, and this is how this means that without cavalry they couldn't hope to make it against another cavalry army. This is true, and naturally certain infantries, especially in very rugged terrain, think about, I don't know, in Wales, as we said before, or in other kind of wilder regions, were could mount up, you know, effective guerrilla tactics, and also obliging the knights to dismount to go get them. Knights in this were pretty adaptable, pretty flexible. They could be used in many ways. It was usually knights, for instance, that stormed the fortresses at this point. It was not the commoners. And the main problem of infantry also in here is kind of inherent to their quality. These were not, I mean, in the 11th century you find infantries, you find much more often men-at-arms dismounted than you find it in the 13th century. So infantry is actually, the more this progresses, the more we're drawn from the commoners, communities that were in this sense not professionals of war but just citizens or urban militias. And these could actually support cavalry, as we've seen. They were very important to carry out this operations, logistic operations, to occupy, to hold certain positions and so on. And they were especially also used as a screen for cavalry to retire, essentially to withdraw. Once again, at the Battle of Ramla, I made a video on that happened. That is quite evident that between a charge and another, cavalry would essentially withdraw and line up behind the infantry, while the infantry was essentially shielding, fencing off the enemy. This was very often used during the Crusades because the Muslim cavalry was on average lighter than the European one, excuse me, than the Western one. So even commoners' militias at this point between the 11th and 13th century are sometimes substantially good. Spearmen, crossbowmen could make this stand against, even we have seen it, especially the infantries of Italy, of communal Italy and of Flanders were prized at this point because they had given a good, very good proof of themselves against the armored knights. And even if they hadn't made it to win a victory against them, they had had the guts to stand against them. It was something at the time was clamorous because it was as if the world had been reversed. With a commoner to stand against a nobleman. And yet these guys did it and had pretty good infantries and also relied on many aspects, chiefly on numbers, naturally, because infantry is effective in this sense only if it's in large numbers. But some of them were also well equipped. Often these commoners infantry made extensive use of crossbows, especially the more in later times there was this constant increase, and crossbows were very deadly for horses. Every time there were crossbows involved in great numbers on the battlefields, where usually a high mortality of horses is registered. But alone, until the 14th century, these infantry couldn't make it against cavalry. They couldn't resist even for one day, like at the Battle of Cortenuova, for instance, and the Lombard infantrymen resisted a whole day against the charges of the German Imperial cavalry. But eventually during the night they had to flee because they realized they couldn't withstand it for another day. But hey, they did it. Where do you find it in the rest of Europe? That was unbelievable by certain standards. Another point is, during the 13th century sometimes, in some of the major battles of the time, we don't even see infantry mentioned within the sources sometimes, which it's probably false. I mean, infantry was still there, but probably it was also, there were certain tactical situations in which it was not used, or maybe it also depends on the strategic theater, because especially if you are invading a foreign land, either you have mercenary infantry at that time, it's probably not going to be a loss of them. It's difficult to bring commoners to fight abroad. So at that point, it would be normal that it was just professionals, and mostly mounted professionals would join this. For instance, the Battle of Tagliacozzo, its infantry is not mentioned. Can we say it was infantry? Well, sure, it was infantry, but simply the sources do not talk about it. The same goes for other episodes. So the idea at this point is the infantry was not considered much of a thing, in spite there were certain developments that were showing that European infantries were growing. We have seen the Italian infantries, we've seen the Flemish infantries. The Flemish infantries at Battle of Bouvines, for instance, in the Anglo-German army, I think, if I'm not wrong, on the right flank, where they enclosed themselves into a phalanx, and they got themselves butchered down till the very last one, when the rest, all the rest of their army had fled the field, and taking, you know, in the process also several French knights with them. So during the 13th century, you see this, you know, there was a development also in infantry, but it was not taken seriously by the nobility, that however made extensive use of these troops for other, especially in siege warfare and so on. For instance, in the conquest of Norman Italy, or Norman Sicily, sorry, it was a, you know, those were areas that were ancient urbanizations, were lots of infrastructures, of fortifications. The Normans conquered, there was no major pitched battle in the conquest of Sicily, but it was just a very methodic, long, and progressive siege of all these various castles that were there. And the Normans at that time were so soaked with this chivalric ideals of the idea of the prevalence of mounted combat and so on. But and they, in their sources, they didn't talk about it, but they were actually relying pretty heavily on all the commoners from the southern Italian cities that brought together with the men, the material to besiege a city, something that knights couldn't do because there were usually too few. In order to besiege a place, you have to surround it to avoid, you know, it's get supplied by others, because otherwise it's useless. And you need men, you need infantry, you need commoners, and you can find them in such numbers, and also with the know-how, with the logistical, technical abilities to carry out this thing. The knight wasn't an engineer most of the time. He didn't care. He was just a fighter, was just a warrior. And so you find this kind of episodes of heroism of this infantryman kind of resisting stubbornly and with a group. But up to the beginning of the 14th century, this didn't bring to any. Thinking about the Scottish children. And sometimes there were also wagon laggers. That were often also deployed behind the infantry, or maybe the infantry also deployed behind it, especially in desperate situations. And this would especially used by commoners, although not always. It was common in various areas of Europe. You find it, especially in the Eastern Europe, much more frequently than what is used, because that was a very effective way to counter the cavalries of the steppes. But you find it also in the rest of Europe, and especially during the later Middle Ages, it's very much revived. Think about the Hussites, that made kind of the their favorite tactics to use these wagons for battles. But it's recorded actually many times in history. It's not a prerogative. It makes sense. You travel with these wagons that you necessarily have to use in the baggage train for bringing things. You use them as a fortification in case of need, in case of emergency. It's not really, you know, if you have to do it, you're probably not in the best situation, but it's still something, and you're going to use it because it works partially, especially against cavalry, because the horses also are very, the horse kind of stops in front of everything that constitutes, or he thinks it constitutes, an obstacle. So sometimes horses are even scared to step on human bodies, and this is also, you need a clear battlefield to operate with cavalry. You can't do it, you know, especially there are paradoxical situations in which the battlefield is so messed up that you can't even direct a cavalry charge into the middle, because you don't exactly know where to hit, because it's also scattered, it's also confused. Sometimes, as we've seen, you know, that it's difficult to find a direction, especially when there is another cavalry from the other side. It was also finding the best moment to attack. All these scattered units might, you know, create also a problem for the cavalry to operate. Talking about missile weapon in conclusion, throughout all these times, missile weapons is not very effective, seemingly, against especially cavalry tactics, but it's definitely increasing over time. Archers and crossbowmen at this time are present also in here, at all times, Although seemingly they were present in small numbers. This has always happened for some reason, and they usually were either fighting in separate units. They were attached usually to two spearmen. This in the common militia was kind of the norm. Some others could be interspersed against, between the ranks or in front of the ranks. Some of these troops skirmished before the battle, but it didn't happen excessively often. It's only towards the end of this period that, also in here with an increase in collective, you know, in organization and discipline and so on, that infantries kind of are more disciplined, more framed to an order. They also use tactically more consistently, in kind of more cohesive way. The best way at all times in history was to deploy the missile troops on your left flank, because that would hit essentially the enemy right flank, which was the one that didn't have the shield, so it could cause more casualties on that side. But sometimes there was also crossfire, and this is what chiefly the Italians, I think, pioneered. If you take the battle of Campaldino in Tuscany in 1229, that's what they did. Essentially, they caused very heavy casualties to the Florentines, caused very heavy casualties to the Aretines by hitting at their horses. And that's why, you know, it was a commoner's weapon. Because you understand that when commoners had consistent numbers of infantry and they used also these crossbows, it was also it was not about that enemy. That enemy army. It was also about targeting a social class. It was the one of the knights that were their enemies, generally speaking. So it's very important, and it's just, however, the English armies from the end of the 13th, but really only in the 14th with Edward III, that began to use this enormous masses, actually, of longbowmen. And that are ordered in a certain way. They're actually issued by the crown. This is something you don't find in other countries in this sense, in such huge numbers. And that's really what made the difference, actually, in here. Because there is also the myth that the longbow was better than the crossbow, and this is absolutely false. But aside from this, you can have all the higher range, higher rate of fire you want with the longbow, but still the crossbow outshoots you. So actually, the reason why the longbow was so effective, and to tell you how it's not really the technology but the doctrine that allows you to achieve certain things, because longbows always existed since prehistory in Europe. It's just because they were put in this such huge masses of men by the English crown. Other continental armies that had crossbows, that had even in this better bolt shooting weapons, we've seen the Italian communes were on the lead in this, but they didn't have the political unity that would trigger the military unity to experiment new tactics, and therefore not really developing a new technology, but using what you already have in a more massive scale to achieve certain results on the battlefield. And also, naturally, the English longbow tactics are very, they were extremely effective. There is no doubt on this, but they still might have been countered in some way. That sometimes was not achieved because of chiefly not of military decisions that also played a part, telling the truth. Because, you know, it's not that battles like Crecy or Poitiers or Azincourt were so massively, the French could still win them. But simply, chiefly for political and social limits of that culture. That also have to be understood, because even if you have those limits, you can still react in a certain way that is still effective. And there's also luck in warfare and so on. However, the longbow armies, let's call them in this way, the English armies at this point, were actually the strongest in military history in terms of ratio of, you know, consecutive battles that they won being constantly outnumbered. There is no army in history, if you look at the numbers, that achieved such results. And I know that there are the whiners who say, oh, well, the Romans, well, this thing. And no, if you look at the numbers, that's it. The English achieved in that 14th and 15th century, such results, such victories, through a rate of, a disparity of numbers in conditions of relative symmetry, because basically medieval France and medieval England were the same things in terms of technology and material culture. It was no difference at all. So repeatedly, and no other army in history achieved such a feat. And the French tank, they have to tank gunpowder because that's how it eventually made it to overcome the tactical problem. It was a real problem. Not much because of the sheer tactics, but the fact that the French crown had difficulties to formulate a different response, let's say, to that tactics because of political and social reasons. Also because of what we said before, relatively to the noblemen and the commoners, the idea, these French knights would say, what war, these kind of, worms that fight on foot, that even are able to stem our, to bog down our cavalry charges and render them ineffective eventually when we arrive to the men-at-arms fighting. This was really a problem. The beginning of the 14th century with the Battle of the Golden Spurs and Battle of Courtrai, all these commoners' victories over the mounted elite were something mind-blowing. It was the world at the reverse in many ways. And it was this roughly 50 years of history, then there is this gap until essentially the 20s, where the mid of the 15th century, when the Swiss kind of revive infantry on different bases compared to the one of the 14th century, although they also in here it's complicated because, of course, the Swiss did win their victories among the one of the 14th century, but they weren't the same thing as, they hadn't the same armies they had in the mid of the 15th, and we will talk extensively about the Swiss also and their tactics, because they're important to understand. The Swiss evolved their army. They weren't the same thing in the 14th and in 15th century, and in the 14th they weren't even that huge much to tell it all. They were mostly helped by the terrain. In the 15th century they were really developing something new that opened to Renaissance warfare and so on. At this time, there were definitely also mounted archers and mounted crossbowmen, as we said before. It was kind of normal, much more normal we would probably think. Also, knights probably used these weapons more than we expect, although their main tactical specialization was heavy cavalry, and heavy cavalry doesn't waste time shooting. They has to concentrate doing something else, but they always existed at all times. And these troops often dismounted, interestingly enough, as well, and considered also in then countries like Hungary, Poland, the Balkans, Russians, and it was plenty of Asiatic horse archers that the local European powers would basically settle to kind of, it was usually the kings who allowed this to counter the push of the nobility. So it was full, actually, also in feudal warfare, especially in Germany, in Hungary, that there were these usually Cuman horse archers were pretty... In the Iberian Peninsula, as we've seen, there were these javelin-armed jinetes. And this is the kind of the firearm cavalry that, existed, but it was sometimes effective, actually, but the most important thing to remember here is that these missile power was effective as long as it was en masse, because objectively also, as we've said before, the degree of protection of heavy cavalry was enough for fence off most of the missiles at this point. So if you see the English armies of 14th century, those victories were achieved because there were literally thousands of longbowmen in those armies, not just hundreds like of archers of crossbows like it was normal in other armies. And so that was done not because it was the longbow was the key, because longbow has always existed, but that because there was a monarchy, it was able to put that together in a way that was also thought you know, without the military genius of Edward III, would have not had probably those English victories in the 14th century. So it's very important. I mean, there would have been other tactics, or they might have not developed. So sometimes, always remember, it's never technology, it's actually doctrine that makes the military history go. So here we go. I think I stop here because I talk extensively. I was happy about what I talked about today. And I think it was useful to give a bit of a presentation of what this warfare was in a nutshell. There is still a freaking lot to tell, and I promise I will do it on Schwerpunkt in the future, so just be patient. If I will leave long enough, if I don't have any other problem, hopefully, I will continue doing this because I like it. And for now, I just hope that you enjoyed this video. If you did, please share it, otherwise leave a like, or subscribe to my channel if you are interested in my upcoming contents. And for now, I thank you heartily for listening to me. I wish you a nice time, and see you next time. Bye.